Good afternoon. And on behalf of Florence's family, I'd like to welcome you here today to the service honoring and celebrating the life of a wonderful human being. My name is Barb McGill, and I'm the full-time minister here. I'm here with Reverend Lark Kim, Luis Molina, and delighted to have the choir here with us today that Florence was such a significant part of for so many years. It's an honor to be here to celebrate the life of Florence Jean Smith. And the family invites you after the service to attend a reception in the Ruby Carroll Hall following the service. Your presence here today makes a difference, as I know your outpouring of care and concern that you've offered in the past few weeks. And saying goodbye to someone we love really truly is one of the hardest things that we have to do in life. Someone like Florence, who may have always been there, someone without whom we can barely imagine our lives. But this is what we have gathered here to do today, to celebrate the life of Florence Jean Smith, to give thanks for all that has been good and loving, to ask forgiveness for anything that was not as we had hoped it would be, and to bring ourselves and all that we feel into the great love that connects us all. And may this love bless you and keep you close. The hymns and scripture this morning were all chosen by the family, and All Things Bright and Beautiful is our first hymn. You will find the words in the PowerPoint behind you. And Florence, really across the board talking to family, loved the outdoors. She loved the campfire, the cottage, and she had an incredible respect for and knowledge of nature and plants that I know that we are going to hear more of as we go along. So choosing this hymn, All Things Bright and Beautiful, is a perfect way to start our time together. So please stand as you're able, and we'll join our voices together.
Oh, Good morning, everyone. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the fellowship with Florence Jean Smith while she was alive for 100 years. Now, you release her from the bondage in life. Lord our God, our hearts rejoice to hear once again the words of eternal life today. We thank you for all the blessings of Florence's life on earth, and above all, for the chance to love and experience of being loved among us, especially with families, neighbors, and in the faith community of Trillium in our church. Jesus said, "There is no greater love than this, that a person should lay down her or his life for the friends." Florence really laid down her life for the family and others. Though sometimes loving brings pain, or carries us to the very center of the meaning of life. As we gather here in loving memory of Florence Jean Smith, have pity on our efforts. Make worthier of the name of Christians, and give each of us comfort and joy in our Lord Jesus now and forevermore. Amen.
As we begin our time of remembering with the family, we have some scripture that was chosen by Florence's granddaughter, Rachel. The first one is from Proverbs, chapter 6, verses 20b to 22. "My child, keep your father's commandment, and do not forsake your mother's teaching. Bind them upon your heart always, and tie them around your neck. When you walk, they will lead you. When you lie down, they will watch over you. And when you awake, they will talk to you." And now we're going to hear from Moira, the oldest daughter of Florence and Jim Smith.
I have to behave. We thank everyone for coming today to celebrate the life of our mother, Florence Jean Kirkby Smith. Thank you, Luis, our very talented music director and choir leader, and the choir, for being part of this service today. Singing in choirs was a very important part of our mother's life, and your presence means so very, very much. Florence and Jim, aka Mom and Dad, started their life journey in Delhi, where Dad received his first teaching position. After the birth of their first daughter, me, they decided it was time to move back to Niagara to be closer to their parents. Our first home was a two-bedroom house on Bessie Street in the town of Meryton. They joined Elm Street United Church, where Mom joined the choir. During the summer of 1953, Mom contracted polio while pregnant with my brother Kirk. We lived in quarantine while she was ill, with Dad taking care of her, cooking, cleaning, boiling all the dishes and laundry to sterilize everything, while taking care of me, a rambunctious three-year-old. Dad would sneak me outside in the middle of the night to run up and down the sidewalk, hoping I would fall asleep after being inside all day. Thankfully, the congregation members of Elm Street United Church were there to support us during this difficult time, dropping off groceries, meals, and the congregation members paid all their bills, as Dad wasn't allowed to leave the house to go to the bank or to work to earn money. My brother Kirk was born in January of 1954, 1 month premature, and thankfully neither Mum or Kirk had any lasting effects from polio. In the spring of 1956, they made the move to Grantham Township, where they bought their house on Hallcrest Avenue. This move was in preparation for the arrival of their second daughter, Shelley. And 14 months later, our family was completed with the arrival of my sister Tara. She was my 7th birthday present. When Tara was about 2, we started to enjoy summer vacations with Aunt Muriel and Uncle Lauren at a rented cottage on Echo Lake. I remember spending lots of time in the water playing on the beach. The lake was very shallow. It was great for wading in. While we played, I remember Mom standing at the end of the dock doing laundry in a large starch kettle pot with a scrub board. Growing up, I have memories of long car rides with Dad behind the wheel and Mom sitting beside him trying to keep us amused. We would play a game looking for cows. The first child to see a cow would yell out, "My cow!" From the back of the car, she would have heard, "My cow! My cow! My cow!" We would also count out many license plates we would spot visiting from other places, played I Spy, singing car songs and eating treats. Juicy fruit gum was a favorite. Mom tore pieces in half so the package would last longer, and it was years before we figured out you could actually chew a whole stick by yourself. Mom was always educating us about things. She would point out drumlins and eskers, explaining how the glaciers had formed them, identifying plants, types of birds, looking for fossils or special rocks on the lakeshore. "Do you know what jopai weed is or viper's bugloss?" We know. We spent many summers camping, sometimes traveling on road trips, other times spending the whole time in one park. Lavallee in Bancroft was where I have many fond memories singing around the campfire with Mother leading each tune. With no thought given as to whether our neighboring campers appreciated the songs, but we sang them each night. For example, "Glory How Peculiar." "One black bug bled blue, black blood, and the other black bug bled blue," and a few other tongue twisters. On one trip, we befriended a group of Boy Scouts, and we joined them around their campfire. Mother led that one too. In grade 6, I did a project on Prince Edward Island. This inspired our parents to use my research to plan a camping trip to the East Coast. Back then, Prince Edward Island was reached by ferry. Our beagle Goldie was not impressed by this experience. Mother held her on her lap for the whole crossing while she was seasick. I think Dad and I were the only ones that didn't feel the effects of the waves. Our summer camping trips took us to the lakehead to see Kakabeka Falls and Pancake Bay. Mom was an expert at drying clothes because rain seemed to be such a large part of all of our holidays. The trip to the West Coast was exceptional. Mom pointed out stellar jays, magpies, Richardson's ground squirrels. We marveled at the difference in the size of black bear traps compared to grizzly bear traps. We visited the mountains, the ice fields, Banff, Lake Louise, Moraine Lake, then on to Vancouver and by ferry to Victoria. During this trip, we had setting up our camp down to a science. In 15 minutes, the canvas tents would be up, the air mattress were filled, the sleeping bags in place, and Mom had supper started on the 3-burner Coleman stove. Teamwork extraordinaire. We drove through the states on our journey home, making a point to stop at Yellowstone National Park, where Mom was excited to see the geyser Old Faithful erupt. We traveled on to Mount Rushmore and Custer's Last Stand. It was so dry there that when Mom made sandwiches for lunch, the bread dried out like toast before she could even butter it. Lots of adventures and great memories were made while we were camping. Sunday dinners were also a special night in our household. Mom would make a roast beef with potatoes, carrots, parsnips, and onions. Then once cooked, the roasting pan full of food would be wrapped in newsprint to keep it warm. And we would drive to Niagara Falls to Grandpa and Grandma Smith's house for dinner. Afterwards, we got to watch Lassie. Goodbye, Lassie. On the black and white TV. While there, my brother, when he was older, and my father did maintenance and gardening. Summer was canning time. Mom's brother, Uncle Bob, owned Arrowhead Farm in Niagara-on-the-Lake. He would give us 2 to 3 bushes of Alberta Freestone peaches, seconds, of course. I remember Mom in her halter top and shorts, dripping in sweat, canning those peaches. She did pears, cherries, bread and butter pickles, Aunt Sylvia's pickles, Thousand Island relish, and crock pickles. You would know them as gherkins. The crock was in the fruit cellar, and she added the sugar daily until they were ready. They were always served with Christmas dinner. At Christmas time, Christmas pudding was a must. Mom made family size and several small ones that she gifted to the milkman, bread man, egg lady, as well as the neighbors. She always included the butterscotch sauce recipe. In hopes of this tradition continuing with the next generation, she invited some of the grandchildren to come over to learn how to make her famous Christmas pudding recipe one year. Christmas also meant light and dark fruit cakes. We helped with the preparation by chopping the candied fruits and nuts whenever she made this. We all have fond memories of our birthday parties. We played games, ate sandwiches or hot dogs, and we always had a cake. Then there was the multitude of lessons to get us all to. When we were little, the three sisters had dance lessons on Saturdays at the Diane Brisson School of Dance. Poor Kirk had to sit there while we had our lessons. Later on, all four of us had piano lessons with Doris Berry. Through the week, more lessons consisted of Kirk advancing in violin. Tara had orchestra for the flute. We played softball, swimming lessons, and other church activities. Mom took us to all of them, and we learned how to behave while waiting for our siblings' activities to complete. Mom taught all of us how to drive in that little Hillman station wagon standard stick shift, of course. I remember the hill on Oakdale Avenue and the stop on Queenston Street. I was terrified I would not work that clutch properly and roll into the car behind me. She took me that way a lot until I mastered it. She was no stranger to tools. Now, it was either the Hillman or the Morris car that would stall out in the middle of the road. She would get out of the car, lift the hood, whack the solenoid with her wrench, restarting it, then she would get back inside and off she would go down the street. Quarantine came to the Smith household when I was in grade 9 when I contracted scarlet fever. Mom had the four of us at home while Dad stayed with his parents so he could continue to work, pay the bills, and deliver groceries and supplies to Mom through the bedroom window. Mom made countless trips upstairs to nurse me while I spent 3 weeks in bed. When I was almost better, my sister Shelley caught it. Shelley recalls memories of playing with paper dolls and toys during this time because all the toys needed to be disposed of afterwards. Mom must have been exhausted by the end. In 1972, our summer vacations changed when my parents bought some land and built a pre-assembled cottage on Horseshoe Lake. The cottage became holiday central for the family. Fishing, swimming, boating, doing jigsaw puzzles, hiking in the forest, playing cards and board games. Crafting was a fun pastime. She'd work on tatting while we did knitting, crocheting, and other crafts. Mom really enjoyed the boat trips to Bull and Buck Lake through the Narrows to see the old train trestle bridge. We would take day trips by car to Charbot Lake for groceries, Perth for the mill store and scissor factory, and many trips to Smith Falls to the Hershey chocolate factory. Mom's love of chocolate stayed to the end. It would not be uncommon for Mom to ask Dad to stop the car so she could pick flowers by the side of the road to use in her arrangements at the cottage and at home. She took furniture refinishing course with Kirk and refinished different pieces, like the antique oak hall tree, which is still in the cottage. Family gatherings were important. Our annual Easton picnic allowed multiple generations to meet and have fun over games and food. Later, she held family game nights, inviting over our cousins, aunts, and uncles, and even our in-laws. We played cards, crokinole, shuffleboard, with lots of fun and kibitzing by all. As we started to get married and adding grandchildren to the family, my parents would host Boxing Day brunch, filling the house with family laughter and fun each Christmas season. Mum would make sure there was a gift under the tree for everyone who came. There are so many memories and so many lessons learned. Thanks for the life you lived, Mum, and by your example, may we continue to share your lessons with the next generation.
Thank you so much, Moira. The second piece of scripture that was chosen today is from 1 John chapter 4, verse 12. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. And now we're going to hear some reflections from Kirk, Jim and Florence's son.
Thanks, sis. You brought up a lot of memories I had forgotten. How 100 years old my mother and so much life. Thank you very much. What I have to say is just going to be a little wrap-up. Life in her later years slowed as her body began to fail. After moving to Heatherwood Retirement Home, she still continued to participate in activities. There was the weekly chair exercise classes, which on occasion I used to join in when I was visiting, sticking my legs up on the chair, and she would do the same thing, and people would laugh. Then I would make sure she had enough quarters for the weekly bingo game. And on Sundays, they had a game called horse racing, which involved shaking the dice. You had a horse, a plastic horse, a wooden track, shook the dice, your number came up, and you'd race along this thing, and the first person to get to the end of the board won all the quarters everybody had laid down. So there was a lot of quarters, and again, you needed four to play, and I quite often found myself that fourth person playing with her friends at the home. Florence continued to tat lace for a while, and when that became difficult, she started participating in painting classes, and she made cards and other craft things. Of course, my sisters made sure there was an ample supply of chocolate. And I always had to make sure. And every time I came to visit, she would offer me some chocolate, even though I'm not supposed to eat it. And I said, just from you, Mom. Struck down by a stroke just short of her 100th birthday, many of her family and friends came to the hospital and were able to say goodbye. Mom was able to respond positively. There's lots more to say about my mom, much more. She will be missed. My hope is that she will be remembered by those who knew her. And if you have stories to tell about your experiences, please don't hesitate to share them, the good and the bad. On hearing of her passing, my childhood friend Alfred Kafer wrote me, and he said, she was the mother to you, but the North Star to all the kids in the neighborhood. I remember her as someone who was organized and made sure that everybody got what they needed. One thing for sure, she didn't suffer fools. My mother did not. I always felt like she trusted me. His sister, Mary Lou, had a nice story to tell. She said, I like Florence too. I remember that Mom took me next door to see her when we got back from our summer trip to California. I dropped my pants, bent over, and RN nurse diagnosed my impetigo. Florence also used to bring over a delicious plum pudding at Christmas, and Mom would give her a pasca at Easter. Florence was a kind and lovely woman, a grand lady. To all her loved ones, she remembered the birthdays with cards, notes, little gifts, and phone calls. To me, Florence spent much of her time involved in promoting, encouraging, supporting, and providing opportunities for others to have positive experiences, singing, performing, participating, doing something quite often beyond our comfort zones. I like the actor Mickey Rooney used to say, hey kids, let's put on a show in the old barn. That was my mother. She was a leader, promoting, commuting, and contributing along with my father and others to the Grantham Music Hall of Productions. Here, my sisters and I performed. We also encouraged friends and family to get involved, which they did. It was a community effort. My sisters and I would also perform as a quartet, me being the more masculine sister. I did fill out the dress nicely, but I thought the work boots was a nice little touch. She supported neighborhood parties and summer campfire sing-alongs during our summer vacations, and she encouraged others to get to know each other. Florence was not an exclusionist. She didn't count anybody out. She saw individuals, not groups. To my sisters and I, she was just mom. My sister Shelley put her feelings into a poem I'd like to share with you right now. It's entitled, My Mother's Hands. Excuse me. I'll gather myself together here. Never forget the hands that raised you. My mother's hands worked hard, that's true. My mother's hands were my first memory. From my crib, she would lift me and set me free. Those hands held my hands, combed my hair, washed my face, helped me dressed, fixed a scratch, tied my shoes, clothes for grace. They cooked, did laundry, baked pies, and washed floors, canned peaches and pears and cherries galore. They helped guide my life for which I was destined. They guided and taught, steered the car to my lessons, cared for me when I was sick, and gave me my medicines. On her last days, I held my hands tight. And I held her hands tight, and I felt her life in me, and I knew she was right. She wanted what was best for me. My mother's hands held my hands tightly. I really wanted her to know that it was okay for her to go. Her hands had taught me and raised me true. She had done in her life what she was meant to do. My mother's hands were special to me. For I look at mine and I see hers. Or it's her hands that I see. Excuse me. On this day of celebration, I ask you to stop and remember and pause just for a while that the lives we have and are living today are filled with so many fleeting moments. And it's in those memories when we can still see and hear her voice. I ask you to consider that happiness of people is not having the best of everything, but to know how to make the best of everything. Essentially, happiness is to love. And be loved. We love you, Florence. Thank you.
Last Tuesday, I was sitting around a coffee table with a group of people from Trillium, and I asked them, I said, tell me or share your stories about Florence Smith. And honestly, I expected two people at that table to know Florence, and everybody at that table had a story of Florence, partially because they'd been in a high school that Jim had taught at and had met Florence. And it's really striking how many connections and how many stories emerged. And what was really striking was the consistency across communities and friendships in how people described Florence. The number one word, I bet some of you can guess, starts with a D, determined. The facilitator of Creative Spirit said this about Florence. This was a midweek arts ministry that runs here at Trillium. She said, I love Florence's spirit and willingness to try things she had never done. Abstract this, black and white what? Pull the string where? She might give me a questioning look, but she still allowed herself to try. She created with great intention and insight, and every so often she would bring in some of her handiwork, her tatting in particular. She did beautiful work and took great pride in the work that she did. You'll notice that all of her daughters are wearing some of her tatting today. She did beautiful work, and some of her art is also down at the side. So when you're going out, Carolyn slipped some of it in. A companion from the writing group wrote, she would have been in her mid-90s when she joined the writing group, but only in age, not in mind or memory. She enhanced our group with her delightful stories. She could describe childhood games in such a way that the listener could recall every action required to compete in the pastime. She had a talent in remembering minute details and describing them with great clarity. Florence will be remembered and respected as the kind, intelligent, and remarkable woman who had almost a century of stories to tell. Reverend Lark and his wife Misu visited Florence regularly, and she inspired Lark to simplify. She has inspired Lark to pare down the 400 books in his library because he was so inspired by the simplicity and clarity in which Florence led her life. Many conversations also closed with a pause and a knowing and warm smile that said, well, you always knew where you stood with Florence. Yeah. She was a beloved chorister and someone valiant enough to try to teach the UCW how to tat. And even when she slowed down, that was not slow enough. An email I received this week finished with, a long, rich life will be celebrated on Saturday. Everyone has a story. And that is what the circle teaches us. We become better people. We become a better species when we take time to hear them. That is how we change the world, really. One story, one voice at a time. So wrote Ojibwe author Richard Wagamese. And I know that each one of us gathered here has different stories and experiences of Florence. And thank you so much to Moira and to Kirk and to Shelley for taking the time to put those stories together for us today. And also to Rachel for choosing the scripture that was read today. Each one was a beautiful testament to who Florence was and the legacy that lives on in those present here today. And it's perhaps because these stories are so important that they are actually one of our greatest paths to healing as we grieve the death of someone who touched our lives so deeply. Another voice that we heard today read from 1 John underlines the centrality of love in all that we do and all that we are. The way that we love one another makes the sacred, the holy, present in our everyday comings and goings. Without love, the world would be a very different place. And we should not be surprised to find that love finds a central place in the stories of our faith. In fact, Jesus said to his followers that they would be recognized to the love that they showed one another. And in choosing this passage, Rachel knew that these words were not about a romantic or soft, fuzzy, or sentimental love, but about a commitment to love, a determination to love, about a love that calls for engagement, a self-giving love that enables us to live in community, in family, in good times, through challenges, and through our differences. Through all that has been shared, we know that Florence understood that love was not just a feeling, but that it was something to be lived out in the day-to-day actions in all of the lives that she touched. This love was lived through engagement in community, through her advocacy and letter writing, when she understood that something was not right, that something just wasn't fair. In her lifelong relationships, in all of the rashes she treated and knees she bandaged as the neighborhood nurse, through showing up over and over again, and through her incredible leadership in the places that made the differences in her life and in the life of others. We have heard a woman who canned and pickled, who made sure her family gatherings happened, that people gathered of all ages and stages to join together in song and in harmony, whether at the house, at church, or around a campfire, who would drop to her knees, hiding and stifling laughter as she and her sister wrapped Christmas presents next to the children's bed very late on Christmas Eve, who taught her children to cartwheel and ensured that their gifts were nurtured. I have a little bracket, stage mom. Florence is known for and will be remembered for her love of her family, for her children, her grandchildren, and for her great-grandchildren. And of course, what we hear today in this time only scratches the surface of a life so well lived, and it is just the beginning of our remembering. And there are many stories and photos in the Ruby Carroll Hall, so please join us and come and share stories, but don't stop. Life offers innumerable opportunities to practice the commandment of love, and it's not a question of doing grand gestures. Rather, it is a question of giving of oneself, sharing one's gifts in consistent and persistent and joyful ways over and over again, giving of one's time, energy, and love. It is not a feeling, it is a way of life. And in a long life such as Florence says, and Kirk touched on this, there are many ups and downs and significant challenges. And it can feel unfair, particularly as physical health declines, we lose our independence, and some of the things that we love to do, we are not able to do anymore. But we know, and Florence knew, that life is clearly not always fair, and that the challenges of living is not how we weather the storms in our life. The challenge of living is not how we weather the storms in our life. Not whether, excuse me, there's a knot in there that's not supposed to be. Challenges of living, how we weather the storms in our life. That is the challenge of living. Not whether or not we can avoid the challenges that life brings. It is a response to these challenges where Florence's love and legacy shine through. To the people of Trillium, they have noted how the Smith family shows up over and over again. You're welcoming in this place from the whole family. They have noted the response of how you showed up and being with Florence through the challenges of changing health and her move. And Florence's family was there by her side, supporting her in life and in death. And this is the love where God is known, where God dwells, and where the beautiful legacy of Florence shines through and lives on. Florence is no longer with us in her physical presence, and yet we know her life continues. Every time you look at her picture, every time you mention her name, you sing in harmony, gather as family and friends, smell the folk from a campfire, even work obsessively on a puzzle into the wee hours of the night, or just when you're about to give up, you might hear, When you start something, you finish it. And she will rise again and remind us of the importance of living and loving each other every other day, each and every day. Florence is held in the arms of our Creator. And for us, we now hold one another with tenderness and kindness, reminded that each and every day just how fragile life is and how precious our relationships are. And that in life, in death, and in life beyond death, we are not alone. So may each of you be blessed in your grieving. May you find the peace that passes understanding. May you know healing in your heart. And may you keep Florence's love ever close, that you might share it with everyone you meet. Amen. And now, as you're able, we'll stand and sing another family favorite hymn, "I, the Lord of Sea and Sky."
Oh,
Let us give thanks to our Creator God. Lord, we thank you for the testimonies we have shared, our sorrows and joy and hope in this service, with renewing our hearts. Let your compassion lead us ever more surely into a new heart and mind, so that we are transformed and we can help in transforming the world. We are determined to hold Florence in our memory and cherish her example of a good life. She is not mere remembered friend. She is someone passing on to us as a victorious Christian with her wisdom, passion, and smiles. Very much organized housework skills and good storyteller. Florence even influenced and inspired me on what is the good and kindness among people, as a beautiful legacy of a spiritual life. We believe your promise that those who trust you shall not be swept away by death, but shall have eternal life. We worship our Lord Jesus because in his mercy he has given us new birth into a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. At this moment, help us put darkness of our lives and look forward to the day of light and gladness. We lift up our hearts and praise you for the unlimited power of your love, with longing for the coming of God's kingdom among us. Let us make our prayers and praise unto one by thanksgiving prayer in the words of Lord Christ, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our closing hymn is, We Shall Go Out with Hope of Resurrection.
sit for now. As part of Florence's time in the writing group in 2017, she wrote a poem called We Live, and I'll use that as our commissioning today. There was a mature woman who lived all by herself. She was a normal human and had a little wealth. She loved to sing a song or two and loved to do her tatting. From vase and flowers, bouquets grew. Thus, days were never lacking. She had some help from family, starting with her son. He fed the birds twice weekly. Squirrels were glad 'twas done. Her eldest daughter came to help, sent books, photos, and papers into a computer off a basement shelf, less time for future makers. One daughter was a soloist and directed our church choir. Another was a flautist, played music all did admire. The only son was a fiddler, was part of many groups. He was not a music reader, but filled with music swoops. The eldest joined the music and ruled about the church, helped to find... I'll let that laugh happen a little bit for a second. Help to her family was fantastic. She drove from porch to perch. The whole family was a big one and gathered once a year. They chatted, laughed, and helped some. Kids played without a fear. The world has been a lot of love, the past for all so great. Until we reach that place above, we are glad of our own fate. Florence J. Kirkby Smith, written January 2017. And as you're able now, I'll ask you to stand for our blessing. May the rose rise up to meet you. May the wind always be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face, and may the rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of God's hands. Too late. Some of you will know this.